Okay. So, good evening, everyone. My name is Jenna Osmus. I'm the Adult Services Coordinator at the Monona Library. And you are here this evening to learn about universal design. We are joined by a couple of the fine folks from Project Home. We have Jason Hafman, who is the Outreach Manager, and Bob Weirough, the Home Repair Coordinator, and who is also certified in universal design. So I'm really excited to learn about this evening, learn about all of this evening. And I think with that, we're gonna hand it over to Jason and Bob, who will tell you a little bit more about themselves, and we will dive into universal design.
I'll do a quick go here. I've been with the agency working, I used to work in our weatherization teams for the first 3.5 years. Now I've been almost 10 years in this role where I help organize the classes as well. The one thing I will say is our classes are not possible without our sponsor, and this tonight it's MG&E, and then also our incredible staff who's super knowledgeable and loves to share what they know with people. And Bob approached me about this class, and once I told Jenna about it, it was all green lights all the way, and we're super excited about it. So we're really glad to have Bob as a resource working for us, but also sharing the information with you tonight. So I'll toss it over to Bob.
All right, thank you. So hopefully you can nod your head if you can see my screen. Outstanding. So again, a little bit more about Project Home. Project Home is a private nonprofit. We've been in business for more than 50 years, serving the local community. We've completed more than 20,000 energy improvement projects. More than 6,000 home repair projects. We are a dementia-friendly business and work with the Office for the Blind and Visually Impaired. We're focused on Energy Trade Ally. We have a number of Building Performance Institute certified building analysts on staff. All our field staff are minimum level certified lead safe and asbestos safe. We are NARI and MABA members, as well as Dame by Local. NARI is the National Association of the Remodeling Industry, and MABA is the Madison Area Builders Association. So a little bit about myself. I am a NARI Master Certified Remodeler and a Universal Design Certified Professional. I am a state licensed lead abatement supervisor and lead risk assessor, state certified asbestos inspector, abatement inspector, and abatement supervisor. I'm a certified dwelling contractor, as well as a uniform dwelling code building inspector, but I am not associated with any municipality. I just hold a credential. I have been doing this for more than 25 years in a number of different capacities. I did serve 8 years in the Wisconsin Air National Guard in civil engineering, essentially doing this. And I attended UW Stout for business with a concentration in construction. So, been doing this a little bit. So just want to briefly touch on safety, since we're mostly talking about, most of my talk is going to be around the remodeling side of things, but certainly I want to, it's always better to do things, if you're doing a renovation project, incorporate some of these principles in it, and if you're building a new home, again, that's a stitch in time saves nine kind of thing. If we can catch some of these and modify it on the front side, that's definitely what we want to do. So homes built before 1978 are presumed to contain lead paint and finishes. Asbestos can be found in floor tile, mastic, and a number of other things, but there's actually it's still being used today. If you bought something from one of the big box stores and it says organic mineral fiber, that could be asbestos. So it is still used today. So it's something just to be aware of. Work wet whenever possible. Mold can be present in wall cavities that have leaks. From an electrical standpoint, get a voltage detector, one of the little pens that you can just see if something's hot without turning the breaker off and guessing, as well as a plug tester. Safety glasses, earplugs, HEPA mask and respirator, gloves, all things that you could envision using as part of your rehab process. So just kind of my goal here is just to really give a bird's eye view of universal design and talk about a little bit about some of my interaction with it and introduce some principles. So what is universal design and why? That phrase was coined in the 80s and 90s and centers around equitable use for all. Universal design encompasses accessible design, aging in place. You'll hear a bunch of different people using principles that really basically circle back to my belief is universal design is just good design and should be invisible most of the time. So a zero-step entry works just as well for parents with a baby stroller as an elderly person with a walking aid. Couple statistics, 20 to 25% of the adults in the U.S. will have some type of disability in their lifetime. Just as a personal thing, after I got credentialed, I had an inner ear infection that gave me wild vertigo for several weeks. I couldn't even stand up. So, you know, the fact that I had some accessibility bars in my shower that are I'll show you a picture of something similar later that really made a difference for me. And you know, it's not there's a bunch of different options that you can do. The other thing that we want to think about is, okay, so who doesn't want a home that's visitable and welcomes all? Just because you might not have some challenges doesn't mean that you might not know somebody who wants to come visit around the holidays or just in general. And we want to have a home that's, you know, really conducive and safe for everybody to come and visit. So the costs for retrofitting an existing home are very real. But, you know, even if you're doing a rehab project that ends up being $30,000 or $40,000, that's a year in a assisted living or nursing home. So eight from a dollars and cents standpoint, in addition to a quality of life standpoint, it can really represent a smart investment in your future. So. So the seven principles of universal design, equitable, same means for all users and avoids segregation or stigmatization, doesn't have to be, you know, obvious that it is universally designed versus some of the other things that you might think of as, from an institutional standpoint. Flexibility accommodates left to right hand dominance, user's pace. And simple, intuitive, accommodate a wide range of literacy and language skills. You know, I'm thinking about a, you know, some assembly instructions that are, you know, a picture is worth 1,000 words. Don't have to find the language that you're, you know, your primary language, whether it's English, French, Spanish, you know, a picture of how that goes together is very good. Perceptible information. So again, pictures, verbal, tactile, the bumps from on the sidewalk are an example of, you know, it's the bumps are giving you information that there's a curb there or you're gonna walk into the street, but it doesn't affect anybody else negatively. A tolerance for error. We're aiming to minimize hazards and provide fail safes whenever possible. Low physical effort. So an example might be a handle set on a door versus a round knob. A handle set you can just push down on or catch with your elbow. You don't necessarily have to have the hand strength to grab a round knob and turn it. Size and space and approach and use. We want to accommodate seated and standing users equally. You know, something as we're talking about door widths, we're talking about, you know, if we move the outlets from down 14 inches off the ground to up to 24 inches off the ground, it accommodates seated users. You know, other people don't have to bend over as far. So it's just, better for everybody in most cases. And adaptability is awesome. So when we build a house, the life cycle of that house could be 100 years. So we want to have it easily adaptable as possible and accommodate as many people over the life cycle of that house as we can. So as we're talking about houses in general, so I kind of just broke it down, entry and circulation. Zero step entries are a great thing if done correctly. Obviously, water drainage is a primary consideration. So we want to have the concrete or whatever's outside slope away from the house. We want to have a covered entry if at all possible. You know, we have snow, we have rain, we have a lot of things that the rest of the country doesn't have. An ADA threshold is a lower bump to roll over. The threshold is the bottom of the door. And a 36 wide entry door has many benefits just besides being wheelchair accessible. Again, that analogy of a baby stroller or, boy, if you're moving things in and out, makes life just that much easier. Wide hallways and interior doors allow for improved circulation. The last house I built personally I put 36 inch wide doors throughout the house. And I didn't think I'd notice it once I thought it'd be easier to move in, but then I wouldn't notice it. But something just as simple as carrying a laundry basket, you don't have to turn the laundry basket sideways to get through the door without banging your knuckles. It was just straight through. So there's a lot of things to, in most cases, a 36 inch wide door isn't a stretch to put in if you're doing some remodeling or planning your house. Wider stairways can accommodate a future stair chair. And I do have another picture here of just what I'm talking about, a stair chair. This is a stair chair, so it actually folds up when it's not being used. So, but if you have, code says you have to have at least a 36 inch wide stair. If you give it another 6 inches, it really makes having that stair lift be not take up most of the staircase, makes it easier to walk by. There's a couple other things that I guess I would point out about this particular one. Obviously, they didn't put the stair railing on the open side. You shouldn't have, or you should have a stair, something to prevent somebody from falling 3 steps to the ground, obviously. But I think they did it that way just to show the stair lift. But a lot of times, even some visual cues, like if you were on the top coming down these stairs, the stair surface and the flooring, there's no, it's going to be tough to discern that. So having some, a lip and that creates a shadow line, and perhaps these risers be white versus the them all being the same color will give you a little bit more depth of vision. So we're trying to prevent some of those trips and falls, and that way you can see the step a little bit better too. Handrails on both sides of the stairs can really provide some security and eliminate some falls. And again, that contrasting risers, we want to provide some visual cues as well. Another room that we're going to spend a lot of time in as we go is the kitchen. I know that I'm 6'3 and change and my wife is 5'4. So we utilize the kitchen in different ways. So the other part of universal design is also just basic ergonomics, as well as the safety component of it. So the over the range microwave is a little bit of a, if we have a boiling pot of water, reaching up for that over the range microwave might not work as well for her. Controls on the front of the cooktop work really well for adults in the home. But, if we have 3-year-olds, maybe we don't want the knobs right on the front of the range that they can reach and get at those a little bit easier. We want to ensure that there's a landing spot next to the oven. I'm not sure. So I didn't find a picture of a convertible cabinet, but instead of having a sink based cabinet, a convertible cabinet might be something where we can just have a false face on the cabinet. So that if somebody down the road needed a accessible, you know, was in a wheelchair, they can take the front panel off the kitchen sink, and then you can have a roll-in sink. Universal design is also things like a touch faucet works for everybody. Having an air switch for the disposal. An air switch is it's a push button. It actually uses a small pneumatic switch for a disposal. And it's a little bit closer to than having to reach across the sink and hit the wall. Raising the dishwasher makes it more comfortable for most folks to use. Having different countertop heights. Again, my wife and I are discussing doing another house, and we're going to have an island that's 4 inches taller. So meal preps for me will be a little bit easier, and having a regular countertop for my wife is going to work out for her. Mixer lifts and slide outs, you know, just bring things up, you know, instead of picking up a 25 or 30 pound mixer and to have it, you know, out of the cabinet and putting it on top of the counter, having that come up on a lift really can be helpful. And obviously slide outs, it's another ergonomic thing. You can get it at the things that are at the back of the cabinet very easily, and it works out well for everybody. Bathrooms. So unless we have small kids, a comfort height or an ADA height toilet work well for most folks. Washlets or bidet seats are becoming more popular. And actually, one of the things that I've heard anecdotally is, you know, they actually, one of the reasons why most adults aren't able to stay in their homes anymore is, you know, a high incidence of urinary tract infections and things like that. And, you know, having a washlet or a bidet seat really can allow you folks to stay in their home a little bit longer. And again, you know, if that's where they want to be, and that's certainly what we want to allow them to do. Ensure when the toilet is installed that it doesn't rock. We use these mighty wedge shims. They're little plastic shims. In the past, I've worked with some folks who swear by the penny method, but one way or another, we want jamming a penny underneath because it's cheaper. And again, it's not going to, a wood shim will rot or compress. We want to make sure that that toilet doesn't rock, gives you a nice solid installation, which won't prevent those leaks from the wax ring down the line. Offset shower valve. Instead of lining up the shower valve with the spout and the head all being in a row, if we slide that shower valve off closer to the edge of the shower, now you're not having to reach into the shower 16 inches or so, 18 inches in some cases, just to reach the valve. If it's closer to the edge, you know, we're really after the safety. And if that shower valve is offset, then we can use an ADA style handheld. The difference between a regular handheld and the ADA version is that bar that goes up and down is actually a grab bar. And we wanna, if we're redoing some renovations in the bathroom, for sure we wanna block for a future bench and a grab or assist bar. So I'm actually gonna pull up can here a couple different grab bar options. They don't all have to be the institutional style, you know, just tube rails. They can be, this is a combination, the top of this particular grab bar is a grab, well, it's a towel bar and a grab bar both. Here's another version of that. So if somebody was walking through here, then they, you know, they can have the towel hangs below it, but then they still have a grab bar to transition across here. Here's that ADA style shower. It's got a handheld, so you can take it off. And if somebody's in a seated position, you can slide it down to that. Or if somebody needs some assistance, you can use that handheld sprayer. And then here's a couple more grab bars that aren't, or assist bars that aren't as institutional looking. I tiled my shower a number of years ago, and I installed these corner shelves just so that I could have a few extra spots to put some shampoo bottles. But that outside outside bar is actually a assist bar. So you can hang on to that if you have soap in your eyes, or really at the end of the day, we're just trying to keep folks safe, especially with wet hands. So one thing I would note with especially these round ones, these polished chrome ones, with wet hands, those aren't always necessarily as awesome as, if we're really looking to use those, having a knurled or a peened finish really gives you a little bit more purchase with your hand. And here's another shower that I did recently. So it does have a number of grab bars. Excuse me. We actually sheeted the alcove with 3/4-inch plywood before we put the shower in, so that we could put as many grab bars in as the client wanted. And this has this actually has a fold-up bench associated with the back wall. So usually you have to put additional blocking behind for that, but it folds up out of the way when it's not needed. And here it is, you know, if you get tired in the shower, need to take a break, it provides you a nice, a solid, you know, it's bolted to the wall. This particular one, I think, is rated for 500 pounds. Another option would be they do make shower stools. But we really want to make sure that as you're sitting down, it's not going to skitter away from you or, you know, present a larger hazard. So we want as much as possible just make sure that it's, if you're going to use a shower stool, that it's going to stay where you put it. And those suction cup grab bars or assist bars are, absolutely terrible. I'd love to see them all go away. We want to use something that if you're going to use it, you know it's going to be secure, you know it's going to be sturdy, and it's not going to pop off the wall when you least expect it. And then this is another example of another grab bar with a towel, a spot to hang your towel underneath. So the other thing that we can, if possible, they make a, if you're going to be doing tile in your bathroom, you can, go what's called a trench drain. So there's no curb to step over. You can roll right into the shower.
Hey, Bob, just before you go on, quick.
Sure.
Story about a few of the things you mentioned, because you know my parents are facing this same sort of thing right now. They've got a low tub shower, and they have one other shower, and you know we had to install grab bars for safety and take care of those things. Those are all important things, especially for them right now at this point in their lives. The other part is they had the original toilets in for quite a while from the 80s. So, and my mom was very resistant to the higher toilet, but now she swears by it. She's like, oh my God, every time I see her, she's like, I'm so glad you put those toilets in. I wouldn't, so much easier to get up, so much easier to use. I'm so happy with them. So if you're hesitant on any of those, a couple of quick stories for you.
Sure. And it's amazing how much it's about 2 inches taller than a normal height toilet. But those 2 inches seem to be a magic 2 inches to make life a whole lot easier. And you know, if you have, a toddler over, or if you have them in your house, you know, they make stools or So there are some other workarounds to that, but they seem to work better for most folks. And usually here we end up doing it in conjunction with, we go to a low flow, flush. So we're saving water at the same time. So it ends up being two birds with one stone kind of moment. So staying in the bathroom here, we're talking about tubs and showers. If you do replace a tub or a shower, make sure that you follow all the recommended activities as well. We had a Kohler unit a number of years ago that Kohler recommends that you put in recommends a couple different options. Doesn't require them, but then we ended up having a warranty issue with one of them, and not related to how it was installed, but because that wasn't we didn't follow all the recommended activities, it made our warranty service that much more difficult. We always mud set our tubs and showers whenever possible. That means that we're putting mortar underneath them, especially some of the acrylic pans tend to crack right where they transition from the flat up to the side. And if we support the whole bottom of the basin, just makes that last that much longer. If you are switching from a tub to a shower, you need to upgrade the drain too. Typically a tub has an 1.5-inch drain. A shower, by code, you have to have a minimum of a 2-inch drain. That's just so that, if your tub drains a little bit slow, it's not that big of a deal. But if a shower doesn't drain fast, then you have water all over your bathroom. So there are many curbless options for even if you have a roll-in shower, they make some compressible bulb style curbs. They also make Best Bath has a really good one that is it's just a flap of vinyl, and that seems to work the best for if you're going to be rolling across it. It crushes the flattest, so it doesn't represent as much of a curb to roll over. Plan ahead for shampoo and accessories. If you're going to be tiling, those corner shelves that I showed you earlier work really well, or put a niche in at a comfortable height, and make sure that you add blocking for future accessories, even if you're not going to install it right away. Those grab bars or assist bars, having that installed, before the shower is put together makes that so much easier. If you are doing tile, especially there's most of the tile that's being installed right now is being installed on, Curdy makes it. It's a Curdy board. It works really well for the installers to put it in. It's really waterproof, but it is very flexible. So it's installing assist bars or grab bars at a later date, if there wasn't something backing it, would be a real challenge. There are some anchors out there that we can install, even if you just have the 1/4-inch acrylic, the fiberglass reinforced acrylic. They do make a special anchor that we can install grab bars on that after the fact. But again, if we have an option, having that solid blocking is always preferred. So if you have the walls torn open, especially if you're doing an alcove, framing it 1.5-inch bigger and then sheeting the whole thing with 3/4-inch plywood, you can put grab bars anywhere you want then. If you are going to block for a bench, make sure that you add, I think they minimum 2x8 or 2x10, depending on the bench manufacturer, just along that back wall where we would mount a bench in the future. It's pennies on the dollar for, if we had to do it after the fact, it's going to be much less effective. We always use a single handle balanced pressure mixing valve with anti-scald technology. Basically what that means is that we can set how much hot water the valve gets. And if somebody else in the house flushes a toilet and the cold water pressure drops, it'll drop the hot water pressure as well, so that you don't get that flood of hot water. If you are moving fixtures and struggle to tie into venting, there are mechanical vents, like a Studer type vent, but you do need to be able to access them. And some municipalities are actually charging you by the vent. For those mechanical vents, you need to actually install an access panel and make sure that you, in some cases, document that you've tested them every year. So just be aware of that. Also, if you're adding a floor fixture in the basement in Madison, you need to add a backwater valve. What that is it's basically just a big check valve. So if you're adding a shower, for instance, is a floor fixture, a toilet is a floor fixture in the basement, you know, you need to add that backwater valve too, if the whole house doesn't have one. There is a product on the market to cut through the tub basins to allow a step through style. I have some real questions about the long-term viability of that, but and once you cut it, it's a forever kind of moment, but that is an option if we're looking for a short-term fix as well. Smart technologies are becoming much more of a underutilized technology in a lot of ways. I know that they're starting to try and ramp up some of the Alexa and Google and some of those technologies, but I've worked with some clients who have done the Alexa light bulbs, for instance, and they walk into a room and Alexa, turn on the lights, and they don't have to find the light switch in the dark, or you can program it so it lights up the whole hallway and into the kitchen, you know, as you come in. So they're having some of those smart technologies really can really make a big difference in some folks' lives. There's everything from front door locks to doorbells, to lighting, comfort controls. Some of those are tied into the Wi-Fi, so your phone can drive, you know, the whole house in some cases without having to wire the whole house for that. Some other examples of fail safes that are built into current technologies. Most water heaters now have a flammable gas sensor that would turn the gas valve off if it sensed gas in the basement. Anti-scald technology built into the shower valves. And then a water bug on your laundry box, basically where you connect your washer and dryer to. A water bug is just a moisture sensor that you can put on the floor next to your washing machine. And if the hose ever burst, it would shut the water off to the washing machine. So while we're talking about laundries, I didn't put it in a slide, but front load washers, especially if you have them up on a pedestal, or a platform. I actually built a platform for mine that the laundry baskets slide underneath the washer and dryer, makes loading and unloading it that much easier. But also, you know, it's up off the ground. I don't have to bend over to the ground. I don't have to reach up and over and into a machine. So really, some of those kinds of ergonomics really can make a big difference in folks' lives. A little bit about electrical. All outlets in the bathroom should be protected by a GFCI. That's a ground fault circuit interrupter. Just because there's moisture present, we want to make sure that everybody stays safe. Any light fixtures above the tub or shower needs to be rated for moisture and be GFCI protected. If you intend to put a warm floor, resistance heat in the floor itself, usually you need a dedicated 20 amp circuit for that. And usually they require a line voltage thermostat, which is a little bit more expensive. But walking in on a warm floor can certainly be something that you appreciate. Consider adding, if you have the walls open and it's an option, considering adding an outlet behind the toilet for a future washlet or the bidet seat. A number of people also put night lights in there so that, if you're having to use the bathroom at 3 a.m. in the morning, you don't have to turn the light on. You know, just having a night light next to the toilet might be enough light for you to not wake yourself up. Ensure that you put in a ventilation fan. Consider a timer. Consider one that has a timer feature versus having to, you know, okay, so we took a shower, we dried off, we turned the fan off as we walk out. Really, we want that fan to run for 20 minutes or so after our shower, just so it gets all that warm, moist air out and we prevent that future mold. If you're planning on installing a whirlpool, make sure that you can access the pumps. Think about how your light fixture will interact with your mirror or medicine cabinet. There have been a number of times where I've run into that where a client picks out a light fixture that has an arm that comes up and over, but then your medicine cabinet, you can't open that because the light's in the way. So just thinking about how the different parts are going to interact with each other. If you are planning on installing a fan with a night light or a heater, a lot of times the electrician needs to know that what fan that is or what specification that is, because he might need additional conductors from the switch to the fan, or if it has a heater, perhaps even its own circuit. There are bulbs and fixtures that allow you to remove the blue light spike from the spectrum if you're sensitive to it. And that kind of comes back to that everybody has a circadian rhythm, and most of the smartphones have, you can choose to turn the blue light off to, you know, before bedtime to not interrupt your sleep. But some people need that in the morning, need that blue light spike in the morning to really wake up. So there are bulbs out there that have where you can take that out and put it back in. So flooring, we really want to pay attention to slip resistance, especially in bathrooms where we might have wet feet. The polished marble might look really beautiful, but if you have wet feet and a polished surface, can really represent a slip and fall hazard, which is definitely not what we want. Consider underlayment requirements. Most hard products like tile or stone require at least a minimum of 1.25 inches of subfloor, or you end up installing an uncoupling membrane like a Detra type. Obviously costs can be an issue in your choices. Consider thresholds and finished floor height. Do I need to trim the door or raise the toilet flange? If I end up putting an additional layer of subfloor and tile on there, am I going to have a big bump at the door that's going to represent either a trip hazard or something that I might need to build a little bit of a ramp outside that door for? So if somebody's in a wheelchair, for instance, that they can roll into that room, make that height transition easily. There's also some products like sheet vinyl that are waterproof. We use a lot of luxury vinyl plank that we can go right over the existing floor in most cases. And the product that we use has a lifetime warranty generally. Excuse me. If you are using a natural product like cork or true linoleum, marmoleum is another green option out there. It's actually made with wood fiber that's held together with the linseed oil or something similar. So they're very green, but many times they're sensitive to prolonged exposure to moisture. If you are considering hiring a contractor, make sure that you get a copy of you get a certificate of insurance from them that just shows that they have a general liability insurance policy and also workman's comp as well in most cases. Get a copy of their license with the state. If it is a general contractor and you live in a house that's older than 1978, by law, they should be a lead safe renovator at minimum as well. And a dwelling contractor should be another certification that they need so that they can actually pull the permit for the work. Get references. whenever possible. Ask questions, get it in writing. Make sure that you get everything in writing, as much as more than you even think you might need. You should have to sign a contract that at minimum states what you're getting, when it will be done, and how much you're paying for it. We are members of the National Association of the Remodeling Industry, NARI, Madison Area Builders Association, and Building Performance Institute, Dane by Local, and among others. They all have published codes of conduct that are documented and required for members to abide with. So that can be another level of assurance that the contractor is going to stand behind the work that they're going to be doing for you. Some other random thoughts: permits, get them. If you hire a contractor, make sure that they pull the permits as required as well. There are products that are sold through big box stores that are on the internet that don't necessarily meet code compliancy. So that is something to double check with your contractor, or if you have any questions, the building inspectors are actually there for your use as well. You know, if you were to call them ahead of time and say, hey, I'm thinking about getting this, or is there a problem with that? Always good to ask the question on the front side so that you don't have to do it twice. Grab or assist bars, put them in whenever possible. Majority of the slips and falls that results in injuries and hospital visits occur in the bathroom. And polished finishes just don't work as well with wet hands. So having that a brushed finish or a knurled or a peened finish really works the best if we're talking about using those with wet hands. There are a number of anchoring options for retrofitting grab bars, but again, if you have the walls open, blocking is always better. One of the other things that I've run into a number of times recently: if you happen to live in a mobile home or have exposed or vulnerable plumbing installation, heat tapes are your friend. Check them annually, every year at a very minimum. But visit our website at www.projecthomewi.org and or like us on Facebook. And then I do have some additional links here for some other organizations that have some really exceptional free advice. The AARP one has a checklist for aging in place. There's a better living design than this. North Carolina College of Design has a, they have a number of resources, as well as the Universal Design Living Laboratory. I should spell check that. And the visibility.org, and there's a homemods.org resource as well. So.
Hey, Bob, something that you've talked about other times, we've talked about universal design, that I think I'd like to hear you say a little more on, because, you know, a lot of these things too are important for people as their vision changes, or maybe vision, you know, lighting isn't that great or whatever, but to avoid some of these, you know, simpler accidents or things that are more avoidable. Mm-hmm. You talked about situations with countertops, you talked about situations with stairs. Could you just elaborate a little bit more on that?
Sure. So one of the things that also happens to all of us as we age is our lenses actually get a little bit more opaque, and some of the we talked about the blue light, but just in general, we need more light as we age. So I always err on the side of having too much light. You could always dim it down, but especially with the LEDs, you don't have you don't have the heat that you used to have in the past, or, oh, there's too many watts. It's overloading circuits and some of that, you know, under cabinet light strips. It's an LED tape now even. So we really want to get as much task lighting as possible. And again, having some of those contrasts, especially if there's a, a step involved or something like that can really be helpful.
And you said that too about like countertops as well, like how the design oftentimes, you know, for someone to tell where the edge of the countertop is rather than that being the same all the way across, just like a step, there's there's like a difference in either color or design with that.
Yes. Yes. Anytime, you know, especially, you know, if in the morning, you know, if somebody has put their glasses on or something like that, having contrasting countertops can really be helpful. I don't know if that got where you're going, but yeah.
So I think this is a great time. If folks have questions, send them in through the chat, or if you want to unmute yourself, feel free to do that as well. One question that I had, is it okay to kind of jump into some Q&A?
Absolutely.
Is that great? Okay. So if you're building a new home or doing a major remodel, right, there's lots of opportunities. If you aren't going into a project like that, what are like, what's the top five list of really simple things that you can do that might have really big impact? Or how would you suggest kind of prioritizing if you're doing smaller incremental projects?
So really we want to make sure most of the slips and falls happen in the bathroom. So really that ends up being more of a safety mindset than ergonomic in some cases. You know, the flooring tile that we might choose, or you know, the blocking for the grab bars and some of, you know, the grab bars that we choose and the finishes that we choose. That would be a something that's more of a, usually that's not as much of a, yes, we want it to look nice, but really overarching, that's where a lot of the slips and falls happen. So that's a really safety-minded mindset in that space, where the kitchen, everybody hangs out in the kitchen. That might be something that maybe we want to choose some different, you know, how that space interacts with people visiting. You know, do I have enough light here? Not that I want the bathroom to be dull and dark and dingy or whatever, but you know, having those different spaces have different needs. And I guess I would just really think about that, you know, how can I make this space? How can I plan ahead? How can I make this an adaptive space? You know, the circulation, give it a wide doorway as much as possible, some of those kinds of things.
And I think, just to follow up on that, I think Bob said a couple of the big ones just before too, which was the lighting. Make sure you have enough light in spaces, because, you know, with the just for example, with the wattage of LEDs versus what, you know, old light bulbs used to be incandescents, I mean, you can add a whole lot more lights. And if we can see what's in our space, we can be a lot safer. And then the other one is flooring in the bathrooms, yes, but even in other parts, you know, I mean, sometimes people have big entryways with tile. You know, we're coming in from outdoors, our shoes are slippery, stuff like that. So changing that flooring to something that has a little bit more to it, and the vinyl plank is a good option that has some texture to it. Those are good places to start.
Another thing that I thought of as you were sharing or talking about outlets, you know, as I've kind of learned more about universal design, like as I was getting excited for this program, and I think about the library as a space quite a bit, right? It's not a residential space, but it's a public place that we want to be accessible for as many people as possible. And then when you were talking about outlets, to move them up so they're more accessible as we age, that also takes them out of the reach of our really young ones, that we're often trying to, you know, put caps in and all of that. And so I just, it's like, oh, that's a way that it really is making it safer for like birth to 109,
sure.
Right?
Sure. And most of the new outlets are going to be, have the tamper resistant feature to them. So you can't stick a fork in them or little fingers in them. But we did do another project for a client that we kind of built a little nook under the stairs. And we put in a USB hub so that they could plug into their Kindle in, mm-hmm. and kind of hide in their reading nook. But there wasn't any, they could charge it didn't have to have an outlet in there, but it was just kind of, yes, they've got somewhere to plug their charger in, but it wasn't like, oh, I need to worry about what else is going to get stuck in there, or their little brother are going to get in there and whatever. So, yeah. Great. If we are designing some of those spaces, we can incorporate different options.
Mm-hmm. I know another thing Bob's talked about, I know we got a question in the chat too, but I just wanted to follow up was, if you're doing, if you're changing a sink in your bathroom, which is a smaller project generally, right? Maybe you had a cabinet vanity before, but you need more space because maybe you do need to get a wheelchair in there now. The type of sink you choose to create that space, there are different options for that. And then that's, again, one that's going to be universally easier for everybody. And if you want to add some additional shelving in, well, then you can put that in a different spot for storage.
Okay, so I think we are set. I think we're good. We know everything. No, we know how to ask smart questions for the next step. That's always the thing. Sure. So thank you very much, both Bob and Jason, for being here and sharing so much really great information. Yeah. I will send an email out early next week to everyone with resources and a recording. And for folks that joined us this evening, if you have more questions, send them my way. And I will try to help connect you with resources that you need. So everyone, have a great night. Thank you for being here and stay safe, stay warm. All right. Yeah.
Thanks for having us.
Good night, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.